Stream 3 for the fifth round of the GT1 World Series 2013, 6 hours off South City Long. Chris Wilkinson here, and alongside me is the most crazy, massive commentary team I've ever had before. So I'm just going to look down the list. We have Chris Ford, we have Thilo Falkenberg, we have Oscar Hardrick, and we have Steve Martin as well. Everyone here, and we'll start with you, Chris, because we haven't seen you here for a long, long time.
Chris, since the 24-hour race, weren't here for. Is that is that right? Oh,
that might be right.
I did 16 hours for an L when you couldn't be bothered to show up, and
I was pretending I was in Africa.
You were in the woods, weren't you?
I was in the woods. I was in Africa.
Yeah. Anyway, so you haven't seen me for a while. So what was the question?
The question was, we're here at South City, and we've already seen a massive, massive dynamic change with the qualifying results. Talk us through them.
To be perfectly honest, I think that South City, I expected to favour the FZR a little bit more than it seems to have. And FXR is on pole position, as you'd sort of expect at South City. Vortex will lead us round, which is going to be interesting when an XR comes up to attempt to pass them, because I'm not entirely convinced Vortex will be able to maintain their pace from qualifying over the whole 6 hours today. Infinity Sports and Ixon are right up there as well, before championship leaders in X are fourth, with Genuine Racing in fifth. Quite honestly, it's not that much of a surprise that NX didn't pull the lap together. I think that fourth is a decent result for them in XRR. They will be possibly slightly perturbed to see Infinity and Exxon in XRRs ahead of them, but still, fourth is a good place to start. Apart from at South City, because South City, it's got that nasty kink, left-hand kink at the start, and you've got a nasty little sort of narrowing right-hand kink with a wall on the right-hand side. Quite honestly, anything could happen at the start of this race. It usually does at South City. My first memory of South City is a massive accident in 2008 IGTC, where we had three cars flipping over out of the track. I mean, these sort of things can happen in the concrete twists and turns of South City.
And also, Oscar, we can't forget about those Armco barriers, can we? They're not very forgiving, are they?
Not at all. Obviously, every round the season has had walls or barriers of some sort, but they've had a nice big gravel trap. I say nice, some people got stuck in them, but there was room to slow down if you made a mistake. At South City, there is rarely room to slow down if you make a mistake, and even less room to slow down if you're getting pushed off when you're in a battle with someone else and they make a mistake. So it's a very unforgiving track. It's why you hear Chris talk about so many big accidents here. As soon as one person makes a mistake, they've gone off, and because, again, street circuits being a little narrower than we've experienced so far this series, well, it's just going to collect everyone. Big crashes are order of the day, and I expect it to be a bit mental from start to finish.
And Stephen, someone with a lot of admin experience in recent months, how are the guys up in the admin box going to actually deal with incidents and things like that today? Because it's going to be very, very busy, I imagine.
Indeed, I imagine there's going to be an awful lot of incidents for the reasons before. It's very narrow, and it's a natural home for incidents, and they're going to have to keep on their toes, look out for things, but also try and adjudicate on who's been naughty, who's been causing the incidents, and punish them accordingly.
Yep, well, the guys doing that up in the top, Jonathan Palmer will be our race director today, and as normal, Stuart Baker will be hoping not to spin again in the safety car. As we wait for the start of the rolling laps and the start of the race, we'll take a quick look through the grid, through the series championship as we stand, and it's NX Racing leading the championship still on 256 points, 46 points clear of Team Virus. Genuine Racing are third in the championship, 46 points shy as well, equal on points with Team Virus. Conquest Racing are fourth. Stig Breeding Program Pro are fifth, with sixth being Stig Breeding Program's amateur effort. That's also the championship leading amateur car at the moment, comfortably as a matter of fact. Core Racing Pro 2 are seventh, eighth the Genuine Racing 2. Terra Mind Factory Pro are ninth, tenth are Ixie and SimSports Pro. 11th are Conquest Racing, 12th NX Racing 2, Savage Sim Sports 13th, 14th Helm Neck Racing, 15th Core Racing Pro Number 1. Aslak Motorsports is 16th. 17th are Scuderia Gas. 18th, Aslak Motorsports, Team Virus 19th. Our pole sitters for the day, Vortex.eu, who have changed from the XRR now to the FXR. They were in 20th position. 21st are Infinity Esports Amateur. 22nd, Green Angus Racing. 23rd, ASX Motorsport. 24th are Diablo Skins. 25th, Team Rock Racing. 26th are Team 6. 6th, A Fondo, I believe that's how you say it. I've been saying that wrong all season. 27th are R-Force. 28th, World Class Lions. 29th, Savage Sim Sports 2. 30th are Core Racing Amateur. Steve Breed and Crow Round number 2 are 31st. 32nd, Infinity Esports Pro. 33rd, Team Virus 2. 34th, Mafia Racing. 35th, Last Lap Motorsport Bus. Green Angus Racing 2. 36th, 37th, Terra Mind Factory Pro number 2. 38th, Dixie Sim Sports XRR. 39th, Savage Sim Sports 2. 40th, Gravity Racing Team. Meridian Racing Team 41st. 42nd, Dixie Sim Sports. 43rd, Unknown Racers. And Extreme Racing are 44th.
Got there eventually.
Hey, there we go.
Now, I was just thinking, whilst you were going through the championship standings, that in the season so far, we have seen multiple red flags due to incidents, and we've seen those red flags on tracks where there is more room to manoeuvre through the first couple of corners than here. So I'm thinking, what would you reckon the odds are on getting a red flag early in this one today?
I think there will be. Certainly the last time I was here, there was. GTL the last time I commentated on a race from South City. It's been a long, long time, so... but yes, I do think there's a very, very high chance of that happening. Up the front, we've got two guys out in the pit lane. Dolder and Hassanin. For LLM and LLM.
The LLM bus and LLM bus 2, which I believe is a team that's been introduced for this round, probably because the FXR is actually pretty decent around here.
It's our ball sitter, it's up to you, man, too, from Vortex.eu. That white FXR, the car defeating qualifying. 1:28.75, 48.2 seconds faster than anything Esport Pro, who line up behind them in second place. Hot drops started to race them. Very, very close to qualifying, top end of the field, at the sharp end, so a lot of potential for some very, very close racing today here from South City.
Flip. Looks like we've also had Green Angus Racing 2 have gone on for during this pace lap. Some damage to the front of that car already and just catching up to the pack again now.
The guys forming up, I need to take a green flag. On the outside, doubling up now as we come onto the pit straight, and our safety car, Stuart Baker, in nicely now into the long, long pit lane here in South City Line. And as we prepare, you've got Sam Steevansu on the right hand side.
Green flag!
A green flag flies, and it's a great start left for the next race. Pulling out. Boom, drafting on the inside as well as you come into the first kick for the first time. And around the outside goes Koprox and takes the lead there for Infinity Esports. But can he?
Oh, he's got Conquest down
the inside. He can.
Conquest
Racing 2 were off in the background, yep. And up in the front, it's still Yavadu. Very, very sideways there from Infinity Esports to the fore. Gathers it back together. Looking like it was only single incident there with Conquest Racing so far on this first lap.
That's the backfire at further back, that's LLM, Green Angus Racing. I think that was two Savage Sim Sports. Yeah, a few caught up in that, and I think maybe even Conquest Am again caught up in that.
looks like it because the front damage is new.
Oh, big collision there, the hairpin as well. Meter and racing coming together.
Stick breeding program, amateurs hitting the wall on the straight.
Gotta say that was actually one of the worst starts I think I've ever seen to a race by Infant Esports Pro, and quite honestly they're amazingly lucky that they did not get swamped up. The reason they didn't get swamped up is because the NX Racing Car line had such a good start they gave them up. So they're very lucky to be in second position at the moment.
Yeah, meanwhile here's 3 wide, we're in the turn number one, Jagodic, Lekomaki, and around the outside. Gores, Yasalo for Team Fire is a great move for that XRR. Jumping 2 places past Stick Breeding Program, past Blast That Motorsports, to jump up into 10th place.
Alright, was sort of something that was just waiting to happen there for Lekomaki coming through turn 1 if you're on the outside. I mean, you're going to be showing the wall fairly soon.
Yep, you're right, we're up in front still. Sam Sivansu for Vortex.eu. Side by side, I'm further back up a little bit than Christoph. Greeder and Corpus number 1 for 19th position there, having a little bit of a sort of greeting hairpin. Seems not good to pull away there for the court effort.
Certainly would be. Battling just behind Greg Keogh here between LLM and NVE Esports Amateur. And also of note, the 74 car, Marida Racing Team, expect to see a drive-in penalty for them in the incorrect place. Return to the NDR Series 3 team in that FXR. Drew Curran by Pierre Perron, who actually got the amateur pole effectively behind the amateur car.
And it's worth wondering how the hell has Pierre Perron managed to get himself in an AM car? He's been driving GTs and LFS since I can remember, so they may be on that verge between AM and Pro, in terms of the drivers in the car today.
Side by side between Taskin and Maries though, fourth place, sorry. It's Taskin that holds up Maries for just long enough to be able to hold on to that fourth position for Ixi and SimSport. Maris come past the car of Goik Conquest Racing in the past lap to take fifth place and start putting a little bit of pressure on the Ixion guys, but not being able to get by. Hajime, meanwhile, coming under attack from Pekka Rinne. Pekka Rinne must have also got past Pierre Perron now. There's two XRRs battling away at Virus Pro and Genuine Racing. outside a little bit further as well, coming onto the pit straight.
Down into turn number two, there's a car sideways in the battle, the three-way battle. It's Stig Breen Program, last lap motorsports, and it looks like the other Stig Breen Program car.
Yes, it
is.
One of
them is very sideways.
Yep, that was the Honda 54 car. That ended up being
the inside. He sticks it down the inside of Athletic Racing, our winners of the 24 hour race in amateur classic. Keogh gets a better rub out of the corner, makes this pass stick.
Helnet Racing getting beaten, battered there by the LLM Pro car, who in turn got tapped sideways by Gunsman, who's left with nowhere to go as Gunsman the 14 goes sideways.
Yep, he's under a little bit of pressure from Mark Pyle now as well. Mark Pyle and Martin back.
Who hits Gunsman for some reason?
Look
down the inside, goes the end for the eSports car, nearly making contact with the core car in a very, very bad way, coming into that final corner, or effectively the final corner.
Oh, Gunsman chops across the nose of Kapow there, says no, very, very, but this is only a four-way battle. Gunsman is a little bit more of a at the moment. Side by side, the eSports and Savage Sims, oh, it's contact!
That's gone wrong.
No. And there's one contact. Oh, he's on the most a massive accident! And that'll be a scene. No, he's back on his wheels.
So lucky that nobody collected him as well.
That was actually big, that. That car was ruined.
Yeah, that was a unfortunate incident for Core. They did absolutely nothing wrong. It was some forceful driving, shall we say.
Yeah, I think there it's just Infinity turning way, way too soon for a side-by-side move there, and hitting the wall, got turned around. Paul Barbosa had nowhere to go in that instant. So that's Core Pro Tuesday for a pretty awful start. 10 minutes in.
Still 5 hours of minutes to go, of course, to try and cover the situation a little, but hard to bear early on in the endurance race. Nathan the Moth. Punting or attempting to lead under a little bit of pressure. Lead around Green Angus Racing and the LLM car of Nathan Lamont just not being able to pull up the gap as much as he would like.
Vortex on the planet at the front there, FXR, just now your Ransu reeling off the fastest laps at the moment. We've seen this before, of course, in Super GT from Vortex. They normally have a great race until one of their drivers forgets that cars don't just magically vanish when they're coming out to lap them, and they end up normally taking a couple of cars out. So, now we hope that they won't do that today.
And Bob Bose from the pit lane, and that's actually someone has come in to take over the Infinity AM car, so presumably they have suffered severe damage from that incident as well. They'll go in to take over from Wojciech for the 59 car.
Yeah, the right hand side is completely smashed in. So you can get with that sort of damage here at South City. I'm surprised they're going to change drivers and pit, actually. Very, very surprised.
Maybe they're not. It looks like Largo's actually just coming and run away again.
Unless maybe it's an attempt to get a second opinion on the actual damage, see if it's worth coming in.
Could be.
We've all done it. Side by side, further ahead between Ben Keel and Nestoras again. Caught and Helenek down the inside. Look, Helenek into the final corner, the final hairpin. Ben Keel's going to get a good, good run for that wider line. Hold on to the 14th position for now. Helenek Racing on the FXR, you would have expected a little bit of a better performance in qualifying from them, wouldn't you?
A little bit. It's almost as though they were struggling with the one lap pace.
And they're on the outside, they go through turn two, sorry.
and are going to be able to mount challenge. Going down the inside of the three of Ben Keogh again. Ben Keogh only giving just enough room and managing to sneak around the outside. Well done, Ben, holding them off this long. We've got Fedoriaz for LLM also starting to approach this battle.
I was just saying, Helling Racing were definitely off pace in qualifying, but they're seemingly not off pace in the race. I mean, this is the sort of place that they've run all season, and they're just picking up podiums in class from other people going off. So, fairly standard race pace from Helling Racing here, although, as you say, that one lap pace was off what you'd have hoped.
They are currently sixth in the amateur class, so an awesome performance from them so far, of course, but still hopefully looking up and a lot to be desired. Side by side though between Lehtomäki and Zajdzio. Big brilliant programme going on the inside, looking down the inside of Ixion. Ixion turning in very, very sharply.
A little bit around rubbing their door handles.
And side by side coming through the sweepers. Now this is a very, very scary place to go side by side, isn't it, gents? Even just through there.
Isn't it? Well, going side by side anywhere on South City is scary enough.
Into the kick, still side by side. We've already seen contact there once, we know how it ends. Thankfully, these two can stay sensible. And Ixion, oh, too deep! Ben Keogh needed collecting. And Helling Racing actually losing out to the Ixion car. So that's split up the battle between Ben Keogh diving down the inside of Zajdzio, looking there. Big brilliant program take advantage of the whole thing, but with Ixion going just way too deep into turn two and carrying way too much speed into the Armco he went. And Ben Keogh now all over the back of this big brilliant program car. He wants 12th place and he wants bad, Chris.
Yeah, they're converging on Barbosa as well in the now lapped Core Pro 2 car, as Krompus in 66 has spun it round in turn 8.
Maurice and Toskanen, and the Jenner car goes around the Ixion car.
Yeah, the Ixion car might have pressed some cold fine, but the moment really is going backwards. That's our first FZR into the top four, which to me is rather surprising. I would have thought an FZR would have had a bit more pace here at South City. It's more from an FZR track than it is an XR car. And what on earth is this genuine mixing skin? This is very colourful.
It is, isn't it? It's a bit,
it reminds you of that pony thing.
That pony thing? Oh, yeah. The pony thing!
My Little Pony.
Yes, that. I know Dominic Angle, loves them. Like, goes to bed with them every night, so maybe it's,
But I'm pretty sure Dominic's driving the other genuine racing car.
Yeah, he's driving the
Well, that's probably a good thing,
car.
Otherwise Dominic probably, he'd just sort of go very, very slowly, otherwise he'd be scared of damaging it.
There aren't actually any podiums for
it. No, but it's the colours, isn't it?
I don't think you can describe a colour as like a podium.
Well,
I don't think you can describe the colours of a rainbow.
And then there's
a
light blue base, and that's very My Little Pony like.
Okay, it's done. We have in fact decided now here in the party box that Genuine Racing number 2 have a car coloured like a podium without a podium. Now, back to racing, we have Lehtomäki in between Nesteras and Keogh, who were having that big fight earlier on. Now the Ixion car under pressure from Nesteras. Oh, and again he loses again that Ixion Zimmerman car. Look, incorrect judging turn 2 and way too deep he goes.
Dominic Angle confirms it's not supposed to be a mile pony skin, flying lizard skin.
Basically the same.
you actually just say now, Oscar, that
a pony was the same thing as a flying lizard?
Yes.
Flying lizards are team Coco.
I am aware of that, I'm aware of that, but still. Still.
More than anything, it's to wind up Dominic a bit more.
Well, talking about this colourful car, what is really strange about this is the clutch. It looks like Francois is getting it to red sometimes around this track.
I think it's just because of all the like 90 degree corners and the hair and things like that, that you use much lower gears than you normally do in the FZR, and obviously the quickest way is to flat shift it, but it's not got a sequential gearbox. I imagine around here you'll see most of the FZRs getting particularly warm clutches as they try and flat shift it throughout the slower corners, when really they should be trying to fit a lift in there to save the clutch.
Speaking of FZRs, quite a number of the teams have gone R2, R3 today. Of course, an FXR car, you're on R4, R3, which means that their tyres will be very cold at the end. Now, that looks like it's mattering to our race leaders who are continuing to set the pace. But this is going to be interesting to see how far, for instance, the Genuine Racing car in fourth position can go with R2, R3 compounded tyres.
Tuscan and the slipstream of Marie. Tries the outside lane, won't work through this corner around here, but he's in a perfect position from the start-finish home straight.
I don't think he's going to run as he expected there. He tried to cut back and get in behind the car of Marais a little bit quicker, but misjudged it, turned a little bit too early, but it doesn't seem to matter. We've got a long side around the outside coming into the kick as they go side by side. And that Ixion car powers around and through, retaking the fourth place for now. Maria not being in fight particularly well through turn two, and here comes Koik as well.
This FZR being on R2 or R3, they got to baby their tyres as much as possible on the stage when the tyres are just starting to creep up in temperature. It might mean that they'll be quicker at the end though, we'll just have to see, but they might not go as long. It's a balancing act. Oh, and Leiteraki's around in turn number 3. And our thing says contact with Gunzerman, so I'm assuming that Gunzerman had his nose down the inside and collision is made, and around he went on that Ixion car.
Oh, look at this right side suspension damage he collected. That's quite something.
Well, it's very hard to see and have an incident here and not collect one of these walls, and they provided you hit them on the side, they do tend to give you a good bit of suspension damage, don't they? So unfortunate, but the way of things here is out to be.
Meanwhile, Perron is pretty close to Pikarainen for the E-Team Revival team.
Yes, he is. Not quite close to places through that that tight, twisty technical section. Very, very difficult, as we've already seen, to try and make a move through that technical section, isn't it, guys?
I'd say it's difficult to make a move pretty much everywhere around this track. It's always a struggle and it always seems to lead to contact when you're trying to throw it up the inside.
I think the safest place is into the first happen, because you've got the room on the inside.
First happen in the final as well, that final happen is also a place you can try and make a dive.
Pickering and on the outside of Hyerman. Hyerman with a mistake, and E-Team picks up two positions here.
Pickering ends around in the final corner.
Yep, Pickering in there, recovering.
Right, yeah, very, very opportunistic by Pierre Baron to steal seventh place from Robert Hyerman and Pickering into noses. And Perron wouldn't be shocked to see him with these guys here battling for third place. Fourth place, rather. Behind this group, Yasaro and Yaganitz. Team Barriers and Stick Breeding Program Pro. They will have just split up as soon as I started watching them. My luck today, by the looks of it. In the car, Conqueror's Priest still trying to get past Nathan Lamoth all the way down to 21st place, and Conquest Racing, a team, guys, seems to have quite a lot of one-lap pace as they try and go side by side, and do go side by side with Nathan Lamoth into the final hairpin, takes his position with ease. But Subaru and Conquest Racing, eighth, almost been very, very quick in one lap, but can never make a full race work, can they?
Does seem to be the way sometimes. I mean, Conquest have not had the easiest of seasons up to now, and judging from Stanley spinning in turn one for the AM team as well, it's not gonna.
Contact between Goig and Maurice, and now look who's opportunistic again, Pierre Perron. And now he's right at the back of Maurice.
Yeah, may they come down the back with a good draft from Pierre Perron. And Maurice going to the inside, defending for his life, coming into this final hairpin, but it's going to be Maurice who's able to break a little bit later, throughout the outside, still holding on. Coming now down this batch, this pitch straight through the kinks, and a little bit of touch on the wall from Perron, and side contact coming down this pitch straight now as well. These two not want to give each other a millimetre, never mind.
Lower wings from Marie, he's back up the inside, contact, continuous contact, still contact, no more contact. If someone made it through that kink, that's how you drive through the kink, ladies and gentlemen. Perron, he's going to go around the outside of him still, no, contact the wall, and Marie again. And the battle is Maurice.
Into the teasing, Perron will have to clean his wounds after that one, because a lot of contact. And a big, actually a very hard contact with the wall in turn two. I don't know if that's caused much damage. Unfortunately, I can't see it. But,
it caused damage, but not too much, I would say. But what is obvious is both suffered from this battle, because the Ixion car is away, and another contact between Perron and Murray.
Yeah, a little tap there from Perron coming into the airpin. It's something we can see all night tonight.
French love for fifth place.
Nowhere near the position to try to move, coming into the final hairpin this time around. Yeah, the love tap not working to his his advantage as effectively as he thought it would, Pierre Perron. So, there's always the next lap.
Yeah, and look at this, he is very close to Maurice. Maybe waiting for once for the first happen.
They were
through the kink of the comb, very, very close to your right, bumper to bumper. And now, no, he's not going to make the move.
He lost a lot of grip in the kink.
Maria turning in quite early still, though, so Maria does have a few nerves about this one. Not entirely comfortable with Pierre Perron behind him. Looking behind this battle as well, we have Robin Heisman and Goik doing battle. Solo involved in this one as well. He's got clear of Jagadit's instinct breeding program further back. Riding on board now with Solo. We get a taste of what it really looks like from the cockpit of one of these cars rifling around South Sydney. Meanwhile, Nestoras trying to get past one of the sleek breeding program cars. Not having much luck there, though. Nicky Yakovich is connected to the server, so I assume there'll be a draft change on the Nixie cars very, very shortly. Gumselman as well going down the inside and overtaking. Excuse me, oh yeah, the 11 car. Oh, excuse me, that was horrible.
Very strange point of time for Tusk to get into the pit line.
It takes 32 minutes in this race. If the clock is anything to go by, which probably isn't. 31 minutes, so we are about a minute late.
Oh, that's going to be a penalty.
What's going to be a penalty, Faber?
Nicky Darkovich just chatted to his teammate Tuskinen. Skype, please. Nicky Darkovich was kicked for that. And the team will get a penalty, I assume.
Well, if they don't actually have any contact with Tuskinen, it might have to be a... It might be something that might have to be... Oh, spinner! Spinner there, it's Jagadits! Jagadits and your Solo side by side through that first kink and a very, very big spin. But Jagadits managed to keep it out of the wall for the most part, I think, and carried on. Oh, that was very, very scary moment for Jagadits. Very high-speed spin through that kink, and it just proves going side by side through there is not as easy as it looks. By side contact between LLM and the other one. It's the eSports amateur. And into the wall go LLM. Meanwhile, looking further forward, Pierre Perron still putting Francois Maria under a little bit of pressure. It's not Francois Maria, it's Maris. Apparently, there's a difference.
Yeah, those two have evened down on lap times the last couple of laps. And let's wait when Tuskinen is going to go to the pit line to serve his drive-through penalty. Dahl that just passed the Infinity Esports car, which is coming to the line.
Yeah.
Again, a strange time to make
pit stop. Yeah, but when I look at his damage, then I can understand why he's pitting that early. Quite significant right front damage. Like half of the bar was filled of the wishbones.
Looking back forwards into 13th and 14th place, Becchio still got it. Here we go. Benkyo and Gundelman are going side by side because Benkyo made a big mistake, contact between the two core racing teammates in fact. And then contact with the wall for Keo.
Tuscan in the pit lane for serving his penalty.
Yeah, we've been quite a while waiting to take that penalty. It's been quite a while since he got it. But it might have let him and his teammates start communicating, which is the main thing, and it's what Nicky Jakovic had to do. Okay,
but
apparently
he lost quite some positions. He's now down in 11th.
He isn't up where he used to be, around the 5th and 6th mark. Pierre Perron still hunting down Maris. Starting to lose a little bit though on this group. I'm looking forward on the spot of this group, on Maris himself. I'm looking forward even further, Samsi Ivansu for Vortex.eu about to start a new lap. His 23rd lap of the race so far. And looking back at where Kotrat is at the bottom of the straight, big gap, 8.76 seconds at the end of the 20 second lap, so big gap between leader and second place, man. Don't forget you can keep up with all the gaps, all the positions, etc., etc., on the NDR tracker at tracker.newdimensionracing.com. And also don't forget we already field any of your questions here on the stream by popping them in the broadcast forum thread,
or of course posting to Twitter.
Yes, do that. Twitter it.
I believe Wilco even has a number of different Twitter apps up for this one.
I have one.
One is a number.
It's more to make my social life easier rather than to assist in Live for Speed broadcasting. If it gets used for that as well, why not? And if I manage to turn Mickey out to fill the two-tone Impreza, then all the merrier.
Which, if you haven't seen, by the way, is beautiful.
Oh, Ben Hill with a mistake, and there goes the LLM car off. The LLM Pro Car. Ben turned into early from the looks of things in the fight with his teammate Gunzelman.
Yep, speaking of Gunzelman, he's putting the pressure on the Stick Breeding Program amateur car now. Stick Breeding Program amateur. Yes, amateur.
Amateur. Green number plate.
They've got the same skin on the plate, so why don't they just change the colour like everybody else does? I don't understand it. I don't understand it. I get angry. You know, you all know I do. Yes, Gunzelman chasing down that stick breeding programme. I'm going to come. Might even have a draft coming out onto the pit straight, Oscar.
Indeed, it's a possibility. I mean, the thing with South City is you don't really have any straights that are long enough to utilise it fully. I'm thinking back to the 24-hour race at Kyoto, you've got such long straights there.
Sorry, you interrupt us, coming down the inside, he comes there, Gunzelman. And a good move. Thank one.
No, it's okay, I've lost my train of thought completely now.
Oh,
We're talking about Kyoto and the straights there compared to the one
Kyoto
long straight
you've got
here.
Straights that are easily twice the length of the longest straight at South City. So even in a car that's down on power, you can utilise the draft well enough to actually make your positions. South City, you've just got to be close enough coming into braking zones or get good runs off of the corners, really. The draft isn't effective enough to always be passing unless you're in the XRR.
Plus, of course, the long straight here is broken up by two kings.
Indeed.
You see this thing as one long straight, so... you're losing a lot of downforce through these kings if you're too close to the man ahead. One can easily say today that there are only men racing.
Well, I think Oscar's saying a good image.
I mean, she?
Well, but none of the...
Oh, Hydeman locking there, sorry, Hydeman locking up, and we're going three wide now through the technical area, Koik and Bigger Red are getting involved again. But Hydeman managed to hold on to it for now. Koik and Bigger Red, and again, as I said, Genuine Racing, Conquest Racing, and Team Virus all involved in this three-way battle still behind Moraes and Perron, and Hydeman there getting very, very late on the brakes, a little bit too deep. Very, very sideways, and somehow managed to hold on to it in that black and gold Genuine Racing car. Going behind him in the Conquest Racing Pro car, got a better race than they normally do. They're sitting in seventh now, Team Virus Pro in front of Team Virus Amateur, who haven't named themselves Virus Pro or Amateur, so they're just the same name, which is really annoying, and the same car, which is really annoying, are in the ninth.
Well, at least the third team actually has a very different name.
I suppose.
E-Team. Because all members of the E-Team, roster are actually on Virus.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Speaking of breakaways, we've had Terra Mine Factory racing at the 24-hour race. They are not around here because they are running out of people.
Oh.
They were the breakaway team from EVO.
Where's EVO?
EVO, well, actually those guys who did the endurance races broke away to Terra Mine Factory, which is a multi-gaming clan.
Where's EVO? Like the rest of EVO?
The rest of EVO is still EVO. They are just not that strongly around the international affairs. They are more in the German hemisphere of Lufthansa communities.
Certainly not hemisphere.
Well... in the dark side of Lufthansa, so to speak. I mean, there is a contrast between the German community and the international.
There is, you're right, I've always noticed that. There is a very strong German community. You know, I've been side by side between Koik and Pigorainen. Pigorainen going down the inside of the final corner, jobs are good, a bit of comfort at the end, jobs still are good.
Speaking of the German community, and speaking of Terra, they actually... they were a breakaway from EVO. And they broke away with Paul Munter, who now said that he goes into different ways than Terra Mine Factory. Suddenly silence in the commentary booth. you wonder why some guys turned off their microphones.
Currently, Dorias and LLM there have been very racy behind Zajon. LLM putting a bit of pressure on the stick breeding program amateur. Which is something we haven't seen so far yet today.
Also, we might see soon a battle for second position, because NX closing up to Infinity Esports.
Yeah, you're right, there are Infinity Esports, and there behind is that price for NX Racing. So far dominating the series, other than... actually, no, I don't even know who won the 24 hours. Who won the 24 hours?
NX. By nearly a lap.
NX, who have been dominating all season, put under a little bit of pressure today. Three wide, sorry, though, going into the complex section, into turn number three. Vidorias, Yitzhazion, and Ben Keel, with Mark DePaul getting involved as well now. EV for somebody there as well, that's interesting to know. But looking further back, we've got Ben Keel, who's been stuck behind this stick breeding program for a number of laps now, ever since that. That incident earlier on, where he managed to skirt past him, and now might be his chance of looking at the hairpin. Squeezed out into the wall.
Of contact.
A little bit. Ben Keogh isn't a man who you'd expect to see making a cheeky little tap into the hairpin to make life
that
easier.
Was a mistake. And now Martin Kapala's right on his back. And yeah, the core car lost so much momentum due to this one little. Nearly another wall contact. Breaking back in.
Another move there from Ben Keel.
Yeah, so, well.
Meanwhile, Pikarinen and Koik there got side by side. Seemingly a mistake from Koik's. Stop the momentum, stop the chance. Current standings, and as we know, Vortex EU still leading with Santi Van Tuur at the wheel. Infinity Sports Pro are second, third are INX Racing, and fourth are Genuine Racing 2. Fifth overall, first in the amateur class is ET. Sixth by Genuine Racing, seventh Conquest Racing Pro. Team Barriers Pro are in, the ninth are amateur. Excuse me, tenth are Stick Breeding Program Pro, excuse me, called Pro 11, 12th are Hanic Racing Team. Core Racing Pro 1 of 13, 14th Stig Breeding Program Amateur, 15th Stig Breeding, 14th Mal Half Warlord, Stig Breeding Program Amateur 15th, 16th Core Racing Amateur, 17th Amateur SimSports 1, that's that much more, plus 18th, 19th Racing SimSports Amateur, Conquest Racing Amateur at 20th, 21st, that's that much more Amateur, 22nd the Green Angus Racing, 23rd are Scuderia Gas, 24th are Lap Lap Motorsport Plus, Team SimSports 2 are 25th, 26th are Green Angus Racing 2, Team 6 here Fondo is 27th, 28th are Orange Pro 2, 29th are Infinity Esports, and Meridia are 30th. No diamonds as yet, a few pit stops here and there, for a few of you know, but so far quite a quiet race, as we have a mistake.
Meridia is... what is Meridia doing? 74?
I don't know, but whatever they've done, they're back on now.
It looked like they went straight, where they were supposed to turn right, and then they backed up and did a 16-time turn.
Peter Rain and Hagen close enough to do a battle, Phelan. Want to talk us through that one?
Yeah. Hyman on the outside. Contact, big contact!
Big contact, big contact!
That car smashed. Oh, Goik nearly avoiding this wounded car. And oh, this virus car is so messed up.
Oh well, it's a big hit for Pickering and the virus car.
And it's not like these small taps you sometimes have with the wall. If you have one giant hit, you have to directly adjust to this big change.
Oh, so that was a tap between the two cars, between Heisman and Pickering. A little bit of lag, a little bit of the tap. Beat it, got inside wall through the kink. Here comes Jagadits looking at Yasalo as well, doing the hairpin. Oh, cheeky love tap there, he's going to be bear with. Trying to get a run down the back straight. But yes, a big impact of Pico Rain, and not one too very good. But
and the 21 on the outside, this won't work. But now the stick reading program side by side with the virus amateur car. Now we've seen a virus car side by side with another car just minutes ago. And in fact they are catching up pretty fast to the wounded virus car. And oh, that's a puncture for stick reading program. They've punctured front right.
That's a puncture very, very early in the race.
Yeah, it looked like it had something to do that they were touching the outside wall under braking.
The outside wall again, very, very hard, trying to get around the corner with that puncture tyre and get it up the way of everybody else who's skewing past them. But a very, very early puncture.
Yeah, just 15 minutes into the race, and don't forget, the first 5 minutes or so were more or less the formation lap. Just a very rough, the car in front of him is not... Oh, well, never mind. Now it's going to be a very interesting corner. Oh, braking late.
Surprisingly well done with, actually. That's,
yeah, well, a bit like it was planned to let those two pass by doing that, but...
I would think he probably was, to be honest. Barbosa being put another lap down, or a lap down by Gubbias, LLM. Barbosa are really going to make up the numbers now after that big incident here earlier on in the race and start of the race. But one lap down, just a couple of chances to come back in the next 5 hours, but it'll be a struggle. Meanwhile, we do have almost a battle now, and in fact, probably is a battle between Perron and Maris. Back up again for fourth place.
The next chapter in this French lap, and they actually have Cronbusch in front of them to lap.
Yep, that could make everything a little more interesting if we come into this, into the sweeping bends at the end of the lap. Ready to start a new.
Yeah, but Cronbusch is really doing a good job letting those two through. Have closed up much better in this technical part if they haven't turned in too early at one point.
Yeah, but it's a common mistake here in South City, and well, it's a common mistake everywhere. But much more amplified in South City by the fact there's a mighty wall on the inside of the corner. That you get an absolute clout if you do that turn early, so.
The good thing, though, is that not every detail of the suspension is simulated, especially of the suspension damage. I mean, turning in too early with concrete and concrete walls and rail guards usually means that you're losing your tire in real life.
Correct. Then you're looking at another phase. But another problem with it that we are certainly overlooking. Is side by side in Kogan Hydman Mill coming into the final quarter.
Yeah, that's another problem of LFS, yeah.
But yes, obviously not going to get your wheel ripped off, but at the same time, if you turn in too early, you're going to lose a lot of time, too. Which we,
and higher man on the outside, and with a big overlap. Goik lifting there for a moment.
Goik does not want to get involved with Robin Heidman through that first corner. We've already seen one Heidman and somebody else making contact.
Pekarainen.
Up in. Yes.
With the virus car.
Pekarainen, mind you, still running in place. Still holding strong. Obviously, the damage isn't too small.
Kind of a miracle to me that Pekarainen stayed out and continuing and finishing the stint from the looks of things.
Well, judging by the amount of time he had to run, he's got a teammate behind him. He's not in a particularly threatening position as we are not even... Oh, no, we are. Sorry. This is my TV director being useless. Meanwhile, Baron has managed to get past Maris. Watch it.
And Baron is the best placed amateur car as well. In the best placed amateur car, I was, have to say. In fourth position.